Our first reading today is from the Old Testament, 1 Samuel chapter 7, chapter 16, verse 7, which can be found in your pew Bible on page 226. But the Lord said to Samuel, "Do not look on his appearance or on the height of his stature, because I have rejected him, for the Lord does not see as mortals see. They look on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart."
Well, our second reading today is St. Matthew's account of Jesus' ride into Jerusalem. We begin reading in verse 1. When they had come near Jerusalem and had reached Bethphage, the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her, and tie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, just say this: the Lord needs them, and he will send them immediately." This took place to fulfill what had been spoken through the prophet, saying, "Tell the daughter of Zion, look, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey, and on a colt, the foal of a donkey." The disciples went and did as Jesus had directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and put their cloaks on them, and he sat on them. A very large crowd spread their cloaks in the road, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and that followed were shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest heaven!" When he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was in turmoil, asking, "Who is this?" The crowds were saying, "This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth in Galilee." May God add his blessing to the reading of his holy word. Let's pause for a moment of prayer. O gracious and loving God, we thank you for this sacred day. We thank you for this chance to remember, to look back upon your earthly ministry, and to give thanks for your blessings that are still in our lives today. To remember your sacrifice and give thanks for the salvation it has brought us today. We pray that you would fill us with your grace as we meditate upon your word. Fill our hearts and our minds and our souls with it so that we can be empowered anew to serve you, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, Jason's baby brother, Stan, was baptized at his church in a beautiful ceremony. Went off perfectly. But after the service, though, Jason sobbed all the way home in the back seat of the car. You know, his father couldn't figure out why. He asked him several times what was wrong. Finally, Jason replied, "Our pastor prayed that Stan and I would be raised in a morally upright Christian home, but I want to stay with you and Mom." Living a Christian life is hard work, and nobody, even us parents, nobody does it perfectly. We've all heard the phrase, "Nobody's perfect," many times. You know, and here's the thing, as long as that phrase remains a fact about us, which it is, but never becomes an excuse for bad decisions that we intentionally make, then that's okay. Because what's most important to God about any of us is not that we're perfect, but it's why we do what we do. See, this world judges our worth, whether we're powerful, whether we're intelligent, whether we're someone who is worthy to be listened to, whether we're successful. That's all based upon many factors that are connected to how things look. How things look in our lives, how we look. But how our society, our community, or sometimes even certain members of our family might think our lives look, frankly, is secondary in God's eyes. Because walking in faith is primarily about every decision we make being a heartfelt attempt on our part to follow Christ and His example. The faith is about waking up every day and saying, I want to be like Jesus. I want to demonstrate my faith in that way and doing the best we can to do that. Now, certain aspects of our lives at certain points might look messy. In fact, they might look like a disaster in some people's opinion for many different reasons. But it's why we're living life the way we are. That is the basis upon which God judges our lives, not only ultimately, but every single moment. It says, God said to the prophet Samuel in our Old Testament reading today, the Lord does not look at the things that people look at. People look at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. And we can see this principle time and again in Jesus' own ministry, including on that first Palm Sunday. That's what's so exciting about Jesus, is how messy his life looked so much of the time. For truthfully, there is very little about Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem on that first Palm Sunday that would have looked pretty to many people in his society. But the whole thing was beautiful to God because of the well-meaning hearts of so many who revolved, and because of why Jesus was there doing it. You know, I've talked in the past a little bit about some of the details surrounding Jesus' Palm Sunday entry into the city. We read in our passage today that Jesus' journey began at Bethphage, which was a small village located at the foot of the east side of the Mount of Olives. Where was that? Well, in your bulletins, I've placed a map for you to look at. That's on one of the pages toward the back of the bulletin, or toward the middle of the back, kind of there, that lets you see Jerusalem as it would have looked in Jesus' day. And on it, you can see where Bethphage was located, this little town. It's highlighted. Now, it's interesting that the word Bethphage is a Hebrew word that meant house of unripe figs. So, evidently, the founders of that village were very proud of their unripe fruit for some reason. We don't know, but I just love it that Jesus chose to start his triumphal entry from unripe fruit, a town called that. But it's from this village where Jesus instructs his followers to go into Jerusalem and secure some transportation, namely a donkey and a colt. Why? Well, it was in fulfillment of the prophecy that St. Matthew mentions in verse 5. But it was also because Israelite leaders, since the days of King Solomon, had ridden donkeys or mules through the east gate of the city when they wanted to make a particular statement. I come in peace. So Jesus was stressing again what he had stressed throughout his ministry, that the kingdom of God wasn't about starting war with the Roman Empire, who were the latest bullies to force themselves upon the Jews. But instead, Jesus wanted something much more ambitious. He was about changing the nature of society itself into a just and peaceful society. And he didn't want to stop just there. He was about giving everyone an opportunity for eternal life beyond this world. So we're told in verse 7 that Jesus gets up on those very humble-looking animals. You know, it wasn't some fancy steed that he mounted. You know, it was a donkey and a colt. He gets up on them and he begins his journey over the Mount of Olives. Certainly nothing fancy looking about that. Further, the Mount of Olives was really more like a ridge of olives in that it's a mile long, running north and south along the entire east side of Jerusalem, about one half a mile out from the city. It's one of the things that made attacking that city very difficult for people who wanted to take over Jerusalem. They had to get over that hill and down and back up again to Jerusalem. So it was a rough climb on both sides in Jesus' day. It would have been a slow-going and bumpy ride for Jesus on a donkey, both up and down that rough ridge, that's for sure. Certainly not a leisurely morning trot over a gently rolling hill. And when Jesus descended the west side of the ridge and entered the Kidron Valley, it sounds so pretty. But it was essentially a large cemetery. Today there are actually above ground graves carved into the rocks on the western side of the Mount of Olives and throughout the valley, because the prophet Zechariah prophesied that God's salvation at the end of days would arrive there. So for thousands of years to this day, people have wanted to be buried where God would someday save the world, in the Kidron Valley. And in fact, today there are more than 150,000 tombs in that valley. But as Jesus was entering into this cemetery, he was doing so at a very important time of the year. It was the beginning of the Passover feast, which was a festival that drew Jews into Jerusalem from all over Israel. And supply and demand regarding housing worked very similar in the ancient world as it works today. Because there were so many people wanting to rent rooms, lodging in Jerusalem itself was extraordinarily expensive, which is why many scholars believe Jesus himself didn't stay in the city the previous night. And it's also why many other people were right there to greet him, as we read in verse 8. St. John's Gospel tells us that many had heard that Jesus was coming, and they eagerly awaited his arrival. But some of those people probably didn't have far to go to greet him, because they were already there, sleeping on the ground or in other humble circumstances outside of the city's walls. See, most of the people who greeted Jesus that day weren't dignitaries sent from the city. They weren't well-fed, well-rested political and cultural leaders who arrived earlier in ornate clothing, you know, smelling of expensive perfume so they could pay homage to the King of Kings. Most of the people in the cemetery that day and involved in shouting Hosanna, they weren't powerful somebodies in Jesus' society who took their beautiful scented robes off and lay them in front of Jesus' donkey to honor him. We know this because St. John tells us in his gospel that the Pharisees, who were some of those elite folks in the city, bemoaned the fact that Jesus was being welcomed by people outside of the city walls. No, most of the people who greeted Jesus that first Palm Sunday didn't have enough money to rent or otherwise bribe their way into a nice room in the city for the festival. Just like that night more than 30 years earlier in Bethlehem when Jesus himself was born, there was no place for them in the Jerusalem Inn, one could say. So I guarantee you they weren't wearing fancy robes or expensive perfume. They were sore, they were tired, and they were wearing the same wrinkled clothes they had on as they traveled many miles in the scorching heat to Jerusalem from their home to worship God in the temple. Their clothes didn't smell like Chanel No. 5 either, but more like Chanel de B.O., one could say. So Jesus' triumphal entry wasn't the prettiest scene by worldly standards. You know, many people in the city involved in other events going on would have looked down from comfortable places that day and laughed at Jesus' procession on a humble donkey through a cemetery, accompanied by fishermen, you know, lowly contractors for the Roman government who worked up north in Galilee. You know, Jesus' procession along a dusty road, greeted by people that many somebodies in the city certainly wouldn't want anywhere near them. You know, some people in high places would have probably mocked Jesus, made fun of him. How do we know? Because they did it so many times, the Gospels tell us, throughout his ministry. People were always laughing behind Jesus' back, mocking him for not being a legitimate authority figure. They would have dismissed him because they felt neither Jesus or his followers looked intelligent, powerful, or successful. But their mockery was nothing more than background noise to God. It was never more than that. And that's because God on that donkey cared for the people who were making fun of him. But quite frankly, he couldn't care less what they had to say about him. All that mattered was why he was there. He was there to make a sacrifice that was beautiful. Beautiful in God's eyes. A heartfelt sacrifice for his disciples and other followers who had sacrificed so much to follow him. He was there not to impress the people looking down at him in the valley, but he was there to sacrifice for those outside of the city that day. Putting the only clothes that they had on that dusty road in front of him so they could honor him. Just as that widow put her last few lepta, her last few coins in the temple treasury, and Jesus, you know, lauded her for doing that. That's what these people were doing. They were giving everything, laying it before Jesus. Jesus was there to sacrifice for them. He was there to sacrifice for the people making fun of him. He was there to sacrifice himself for the entire world. He was there to be pierced for our transgressions and crushed for our iniquities, as the prophet foretold. And so why the world, while they laughed at him, Jesus grieved for their hearts. St. Luke tells us that he cries out during the processional, "Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the city that kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to it. How often have I desired to gather your children together as a hen gathers her brood under her wings, but you were not willing." Oh, I just love Jesus, because he reminds us, not only through his teachings, but through his very life, that when it comes to serving God, how society thinks our lives look doesn't matter. For walking in faith is about why we do what we do. Do we,
every day
genuinely attempt to follow Jesus and his example? If so, then our lives are beautiful to God. We're beautiful to God. And that's all that matters. Following Jesus frees us to pray for those who mock us, frees us to pray for those who don't like us. Following Jesus frees us to follow him with all of our hearts, knowing that at every moment of our lives and in the end, that's all that will make a difference. So may God bless and enrich and magnify our faith in him as we allow that truth about that first Palm Sunday to sink into our hearts and transform us throughout this Holy Week and beyond. Amen.